Tonight's lecture, I have to tell you, gives me incredible sipuk ha-nefesh. That's a term in Hebrew. It's a beautiful term. It means satisfaction of the soul. I feel so great that we together have the opportunity to study the work of some of these very important Rishonim, these early authorities of the Jewish tradition, that otherwise basically don't get any scholarly treatment outside of a handful of maybe a dozen, two dozen researchers who think about the history of the Or Zaru'a. And, you know, here we're going to put it on the internet and make it available to the wider world. So it's such a zchus, such a merit for me. And I thank you so much for giving me the excuse to speak about the Or Zaru'a, because it's a fascinating story. It is, I think if I'm going to give you a one-word description, it is the story of a genius who was so good and so thorough that his work was hardly studied for 600 years. Right? I said that right. He was, and it's an abject lesson in writing that he wrote so comprehensively that his book was literally almost disappeared. Fascinating, and I hope to share with you why. At any rate, let's get started straight with the material, though. This is part of the fall series on the Jews of the Danube River. As those of you who are regulars know, I had this wonderful opportunity to sail the Danube River last month with Kosher River Cruises, which was a fantastic experience because I had the opportunity to actually visit these sites in person, and it's a very different thing studying history from books than it is studying from the actual being in situ, being on location. So we began here in Budapest, and we made our way over through Bratislava, Vienna, and then across the border into Germany, and we flew out from Munich. And I'm hoping to discuss over the course of the next few lectures some of the experiences that we had, and they were absolutely stunning. I will give away one bit from next week's lecture. If you visit my blog, which is jewishhistorylectures.org or henryabramson.com, you'll see I have an article there and a very short video on the kever of the Chasam Sofer, which is a mind-blowing, beautiful monument to this great Jewish leader, and I think it's very worth reading. If you don't have time, then just wait next week. I hope to go over it with you as well. But that's just an example of some of the things we did. Here's the boat that we sailed on. My wife went with me. It was a gewaldic thing. She was my research assistant. And this is in the Wachau Valley in Germany. An amazing time. I'll tell you lots of adventures. But let us go straight to the discussion of today. The Danube River is useful for us in that not only is it a boundary, as you can see here in this map, this is depicting the extent of the Roman Empire at its peak, and the Danube River runs right around here. Here's Budapest right at the top of this left-hand turn. So this is the Danube flowing into the Black Sea. And the Roman Empire basically used the Danube as its northernmost extremity when it reached its peak. But it's also, besides being a border, it's also a connector, because unlike, you know, a mountain range, which would have limited number of passes, you can actually travel along the river, either downriver, it flows from here in the Black Forest out into the Black Sea, but you can travel it upriver as well, because they have these paths on the sides of the river, and you can connect your boat to oxen and then actually have your boat pulled all the way up to whatever destination you have. So anyways, the river is also a connector. The river brings information, culture, ideas, literature, scientific discoveries up and down its course, and as a result, there's a tremendous cross-fertilization of cultures that occur along any river system, especially the Danube, which travels through several national capitals like Vienna, Austria, Bratislava, once Pressburg, capital of Hungary, Budapest, and so on. And also travels through many countries, about 12 countries, I think, on its route. It's one of the most international rivers. So the Danube is especially fascinating in that regard. This map also shows you the Jewish diaspora, which gives you some sense of the antiquity of the Jews of the region. Jews are much more populated in the Italian peninsula from the beginning of the Common Era, and only the tiniest number of Jewish settlements are found in the Danube region, by the 5th, 6th century. We actually do have evidence of Jews from a very early time, comparatively speaking. In Budapest, for example, we actually have coins that date from an early Jewish minter whose name was Shlom, as in Shlomo, and his name is engraved right there in the coin. So we have Jews living there at least from the 900s, possibly the previous two centuries, but very small populations. The person we're discussing today, the Or Zaru'a, the Isaac of Vienna, dates from the 12th and 13th century, so he's not from the very beginning of Danubian Jewish culture, but he is there at a fairly early point, and as we shall see, that's quite significant. By the time you get to the 1900s, of course, the region is jam-packed with Jews. This particular page here shows the concentration of Jews in East Central Europe, with the darker green being the heaviest population centers, constituting about 15% and higher of the population, and the lighter greens indicating smaller numbers. This is useful as a kind of a larger regional map, but when you drill down into the smaller locales, into the villages and into cities, then you see the Jewish population really soar, because Jews are historically very urbanized. That is, at least after the exile from Israel in the first century, Jews seek out urban environments. And as the cities grow, the Jewish population grows as well. In Warsaw, for example, by the turn of the 20th century, you're talking about 30% of the population was Jewish. Budapest, similar numbers. Vienna, not too far away. And in medium-sized towns like, let's say, Berdichev, 77% Jewish, an incredible population of Jews in some of these towns. So you will get this impression as you move through East Central Europe that you have these highly Jewish islands in a sea of non-Jews. Very different urban-rural culture, which can contribute as well to some of the social tensions that would boil over in the much more violent 20th century. So a quick note of thank you to our sponsors. Mr. Christopher and Anne-Marie Bray have long been sponsors of the scholarships that we generate with these lectures, and we also have a few smaller scholarships, very much appreciated, from Mr. Michael Heller in memory of his father and his mother, Mr. Dean Webb, and Mr., this is really cool, Shalom Janish Vili is actually my 17-year-old son's best friend. And I was so amazed when I got this email, Shalom Janishvili. It's weird when your son's friends follow you on Instagram, you know? I think it's a good thing. And then I could say to my own son, I could say, so new? Are you following me on Instagram? You know, his Instagram is blocked. I can't see what he says, but anyways, that was nice. And a couple of anonymous donors. And for those of you who are joining us for the first time, the purpose of this series is to support our students with scholarships. We've raised over $15,000. I'm very proud of that. You can just go to this website, the Friends of Jewish History, if you'd like to sponsor a lecture, partially or fully, whatever you like. Okay, enough good and welfare. Let us talk about the sources that we're going to use for tonight's discussion. So as I mentioned to you earlier, there's remarkably little available on the web about the Or Zaru'a, particularly in the English language. In the Hebrew language, you will find more material, and that's about it. Not even very much in Hebrew. My main sources for tonight's discussion are the works of the classic scholar Ephraim Orbach, who lived from 1912 to 1991. He wrote some very important works on the history of Jewish thought, a book called The Sages, and this other book here called Balei HaTosfot, which was especially important. This is there's about 12 pages in this section, in this book, on the Or Zaru'a, and that is, I think, the most concentrated discussion of the Or Zaru'a as a historical figure anywhere. Despite the fact that the Or Zaru'a, Isaac of Vienna, is cited hundreds of times, perhaps thousands, in the halachic literature, there's very little discussion of his life and activity outside of the Balei Tosfot by Ephraim Orbach. So this is one of the major sources of his biography. We also look at some important articles by Yehoshua Horowitz, who works for the Misrad HaChinuch in the State of Israel, and Monica Sailmakers at the University of Amsterdam wrote some great things on the manuscript. Finally, I have a special thank you to Dr. Simcha Emanuel of Hebrew University. I I happened to see an article that looked really great. I wanted to read it. I didn't have much time to request it, so I just fired off a quick email, and I got the article from him within 30 minutes. So I was really grateful. These are all people who have contributed to my understanding of the life of Isaac of Vienna, and I'm very grateful to all of them. The manuscript. The manuscript is the most amazing story. It is, of course, authored by Isaac of Vienna. Here is the first printing of the manuscript, appeared in Zhytomyr in 1865. The author, Isaac of Vienna, was born somewhere around, not 1880, that should say 1180, sorry for the typo there, 1180, he did not live backwards in time. Who writes these things anyways? And he died somewhere around 1250. We only have the vaguest notions of it because he was constantly rewriting his own work, and he would edit it and make changes, and sometimes those changes will be dated. We know that the last change he dated was 1246, so 1250 is a rough idea of when he actually lived. He studied and taught in medieval Ashkenaz. I'm going to give you a map shortly of what exactly this refers to, but he is one of the foundational thinkers of this sub-civilization we call Ashkenazic Judaism. Last year we spent the entire fall and spring semester speaking about Sephardic Jews. This year we're going to spend a lot more time talking about Ashkenazic Jews, and also next term Italian Jews. Here is a map that gives you a sense of the ethnic groupings. You'll see that the Ashkenazi Jews are in the purple here, but this is a little misleading. It looks like, all of Siberia is Ashkenazic. Meanwhile, even if you include prisoners in the Gulag, there's probably no more than a few hundred Jews out in that massive Siberian expanse. But it is basically northern and western Europe, with the exception of Spain, where of course you have the Sephardic Jews, and also that little bit up there surrounding Amsterdam, where a lot of Sephardic Jews fled. The term Ashkenaz is biblical in nature, and for reasons that are not at all clear, the early Jewish settlers chose to appropriate the term Ashkenaz from the book of Genesis and apply it to the Rhineland in particular, German Jewry. Those German Jews then spread out primarily to the east, where they formed the backbone of Eastern European Judaism, the Polish Jews, the Hungarian Jews, the Russian Jews, and so on. Here's a map that shows you a little bit more detail of what we're looking at. He is called Isaac of Vienna because he is specifically associated with Vienna, but he actually traveled quite a bit around the entire region. He was born in the Czech Republic, which was then Moravia, and he traveled around Germany and France quite significantly, recording his travels, settling down eventually in Vienna, hence the name Isaac of Vienna. Okay, now the legends of the manuscript are fascinating. As I mentioned to you, this large handwritten manuscript was completed most likely around the year 1246. And it was widely cited by the early halakhic authorities, meaning everybody is saying, hundreds of rabbis are saying, the Or Zaru'a says this, the Or Zaru'a, that's the title of the book, says that. But it did not see the light of day as a printed book until 600 years later in the 1860s. Okay, printing is not developed until the 1500s. That's when you start seeing Hebrew printed books. But it is completely incommensurate with the popularity of the book as a manuscript, meaning when it was hand-copied, the Or Zaru'a was one of the foremost authorities of his day and had tremendous influence on later halakhic writers. But when it comes to the time of printing, nobody's printing it. And even after printing has become cheaper and cheaper and more of the classics are coming into common circulation, the Or Zaru'a still remains in manuscript until finally, in the 1860s, two different caches of manuscripts are published, and they see the light of day. How is that possible? So let's just talk a little bit about the discovery, as it were, of the Or Zeruah manuscript. One of the early writers of the discovery is none other than Shai Agnon, very important modern Hebrew writer, winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature. And he describes, I have to tell you up front, it's not true. It's a legend, but you know, he's a writer of fiction, and he writes beautiful fiction. He gives a whole story behind it. So this is not history, this is a legend, and it is attributed to none other than Shai Agnon, but nevertheless, it's beautiful to read it. Here's an English translation. Okay, he writes about, by the way, when he was a young man, and his name is actual Samuel Yosef Tchatchkes. That's an interesting name, right? Tchatchkes is his name. He changed it to Shai Agnon, Shmuel Yosef Agnon, when he came to Israel. But he was traveling through Eastern Europe, passing through Vienna on his way to Israel. When he went to Israel, of course, that's when he became famous. But he writes this when he's passing through Vienna. I heard from the tellers of truth. That's a very literary kind of, you know, flourish. I heard from the tellers of truth that the book Or Zeruah still exists, and it is to be found in a manuscript in the emperor's treasure house in Vienna. I forgot to mention, by the way, that by the time you get to the 1600s, lots of halakhic authorities, this is now 400 years after the book was written, lots of halakhic authorities have said, I have heard quoted in the name of the Or Zeruah, but I myself do not have a copy to consult. Many important figures, the Shach, many commentators on the Code of Jewish Law, they say, I've read that the Or Zeruah says this, but nobody is able to actually look up the source in the original because the manuscripts have all been lost. So in that context, let's continue here. It is to be found in a manuscript in the emperor's treasure house in Vienna. Because of its size, no bookshelf could hold it, and it was held by iron chains in the middle of the hall. When I went to Eretz Israel, I passed through Vienna. I said that I would go and see the book Or Zeruah in the emperor's treasure house. I found a person, and I asked him the way to the emperor's treasure house. He joined me and went with me. As we were walking, I told him that I'm going there to see the book Or Zeruah. You know, it has the trappings of a story here. He said, if so, come, I will tell you what I heard from my fathers. One time a sigh was heard in the emperor's treasure house. He said, what is the sound in my treasure house? They found that those chains were striking against one another with a sort of sighing sound coming from them. They asked their wise men what this was, but they did not know. There was one Jewish wise man there who said, I will tell you. This book is a book of laws of the Jews, and its author was very saintly, and he was a rabbi in our city. Now that some of the Jews of Vienna were about to change the practices of their fathers, this righteous one grieves over this, right? Meaning that the nature of Jewish practice, the nature of Jewish observance, their adherence to traditional halakha, Jewish law, is waning. And so the Or Zeruah, the manuscript itself, is feeling that pain, and the chains are shaking as a result and making this noise. This, Tchatchkes is writing like in the 1890s, I think. So it's definitely late Haskalah. So he's writing about it long after the period, definitely. But yeah, this is a period of great change. Well, how old was he? 1888, yeah. So probably he's writing around 1910s, 1920s is my guess. Very secular period. And what is he continues here? When the emperor heard this, he arose from his throne and said, now I know that the Holy One, blessed be he, troubled my sleep only for this, so that the Jews would not change the practices of their fathers. That same day, the sect of the innovators, meaning like the Maskilim, the reformers, came and asked the emperor's permission to institute new practices in prayer and the like. The emperor rebuked them and sent them forth with a reprimand. So it's kind of a story that reinforces the value of tradition, reinforces the value of adherence to traditional norms, and also, of course, elevates the status of the Or Zeruah. The thing is, it's not true. The manuscript was not in Vienna. The manuscript was actually in London and in Amsterdam, but it's still a good story. Another version of the story, because we do have it, of course, discovered in Amsterdam, is that the book was cast into the sea, and then it was found, amazingly, by a fisherman washed up on shore, and that it was slightly damaged by the sea, but otherwise was perfectly intact, and that's how it made it to the library in Amsterdam. Also, not so likely as well. But what we do have is a series of manuscripts. They are not the entire Or Zaru'a, because as I mentioned earlier, the manuscript, first of all, it's massive. Even in the printed version that we have today, in double columns, it takes up about 8 or 10 inches of shelf space. It's a massive work, tiny letters. He must have been writing basically nonstop for most of his, you know, 6-day weeks about things that he observed and saw and so on. But he was constantly re-editing it, and it's not in order. The volumes overlap in material. It's not a start-to-finish kind of work at all. It was published in two different series. It's called volumes 1 through 4, but in reality, we don't even know which sections came first and which sections came last. It's really quite a mess in terms of its sequencing. We can still garner a lot from it, but I want to return to my question. How is it that it was so important when it was written, and then it ceased to be studied, or it was basically lost within a couple hundred years? And the answer is, his son, Rabbi Moshe, recognized how valuable his father's work was, but it was so big and unwieldy, he published an abbreviated version, which is shown here, still in print, Simane Or Zaru'a, which is like the chapter headings or the signs of the Or Zaru'a, which gives you the boiled down Cliff's Notes version of the Or Zaru'a. So if you are a really serious scholar, then you've got to work through the original manuscript, which is massive, or you can have this very authentic, dedicated, careful edition that just gets to the heart of the decisions that the Or Zaru'a made, and you don't have to worry about all of the back and forth and all of the extraneous information, supposedly extraneous. And as a result, this book, the edited version by his son, was incredibly popular and remained in print all that time. But the Or Zaru'a itself was lost until the 1860s. And only then was the original manuscript returned to. So this is really giving away my original opening statement that it was so good, so comprehensive, so complete that nobody studied it. That they preferred to go to the Simani, the short version, which was really much more adaptable to people's needs. I attended an event just recently for organ donors, halachic organ donors, called an organization called Renewal. And there's an amazing number of Orthodox Jews are the highest single population that performs altruistic kidney donations. Whatever reason it is, Orthodox Jews will actually, you know, just volunteer their kidneys at a much higher rate than the rest of the population. So anyways, they had this one guy who was a Sephardi man who donated one of his kidneys, a beautiful thing. And the day of the operation, he met his recipient, who was an Ashkenazic man. And the Ashkenazic man, apparently, as soon as he came out of his anesthesia, the first thing he said is, "Well, now that I have the kidney of a Sephardic man, can I have rice on Pesach?" Right? So the question is, apparently the answer is no. So the question would be, let's say we made a halakha, that the question was asked, and the great rabbis of the era considered it, and they said no, right? And then that particular precedent was lost. For whatever reason, people lost the piece of paper. It didn't factor into the halakhic tradition once again. And then 50 years later, the same thing happens again, and they go to the great rabbis of the generation, and they look at it, and they make a decision, yes, you can have rice on Pesach. And after they make that decision, someone steps forward and says, wait a second, I found this precedent over here. So the fact that the precedent was not part of their deliberations, does that invalidate their decision? Do they have to restart it again? Or do they say, look, we've been talking about this for 50 years, we're not going to change it now? So that's what happens with the Or Zaru'a, in that the original text is out of halachic circulation for so long, people make decisions in its absence. Do we invalidate those decisions and go back and consider the Or Zaru'a, or do we say, no, it's now settled law? We have several figures like that. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what is this book about. We spent half an hour, and we have not said what's actually in the book. So this is the full set of the Shulchan Aruch, the Code of Jewish Law, just as a background image. The Or Zaru'a is one of the figures in a group of Jews called the Rishonim. This is, of course, familiar to anyone who studied the Talmud or halachic literature. Basically, we have this very important philosophical concept in Judaism that states that the earlier generations have a greater level of spiritual sensitivity, primarily because they are less removed from the revelation at Sinai. The later you go in time, there is a diminution. Good, thank you, that's good. Diminution of the generations. The phrase in Hebrew is yiridas hadoros, a decline of the generations, because they're further away from the Sinaitic experience. Now, the later generations may have much more knowledge. Like I said, my iPhone has a tremendous amount of Torah in it, and I can access it very easily, but I don't have the same spiritual sensitivity that my predecessors had. And that has a lot of impact on how decisions are made. In those decline of generations, there are kind of like big chunks that are divided in our historiography and in our halakhic literature, and we say, okay, these 10 generations belong to this group, and then there's a big drop off, and there's another 10 generations belong to another group, and so on. The Rishonim are the first generation of European Torah scholars. That means after the decline of the Jewish civilization, primarily in Babylon, where the Talmuds are written, and the generation that succeeded them, called the Geonim in the Mesopotamian region, then you have a rise of Jewish scholarship in places like Spain, in the Rhineland, you know, Rashi, people like that are growing up. Those people are called the Rishonim. It means the first ones. There's a series of rabbis that go basically from about the 850s, 900, till about 1400. All the rabbis who thought in that time are Rishonim. The period afterward is called the Acharonim, or the later ones, and that extends up until maybe the 1800s. And now we're in, for the last 200 years, contemporary thinkers. So he is one of these classic periods he was a Rishon, one of these first ones. And it makes a difference because in terms of categorizing disputes, an Acharon generally will not have the authority to override a Rishon. And only another Rishon can override a Rishon. So many of the debates that we have today are really continuations of the debates that were presented in the early times. I'll give you one very important debate, for example, that's quite significant. One of the major debates in American society right now, the election we'll have tomorrow will have an impact on this, of course, is what exactly is the Jewish position on abortion? So it's not a straightforward thing. We should not take our theological positions from what's in the general press, because that tends to be dominated by evangelical Christianity, you know, as they say, bless their hearts, but it's not halachic, it's not what Judaism says. So there is no question that terminating a pregnancy is not only permitted under certain circumstances in halacha, it's actually mandated. It's required, specifically a therapeutic abortion where the mother's health is in danger. And Talmudic law is completely clear, Mishnaic law, that a woman's health takes precedence over the survival of the fetus. Now, the question that comes up in the period of the Rishonim to illustrate this point is, why is that true? There's no disagreement that it is true. The question is, why is it true? The Rambam, Maimonides, very important Rishon, lived the same time as the Or Zaru'a, wrote that it's because the fetus, as it were, takes on the halakhic status of a rodef, of a pursuer, meaning the child is unwittingly seeking to kill his or her mother. that the child's birth in itself is a danger to the mother, and unfortunately, under those circumstances, we're required to kill the rodafe, or at least disable the rodafe, in order to allow the nirdaf, the pursued one, to survive. It is, as it were, according to Maimonides, a sanctioned form of murder. According to Rashi, also a Rishon, he says, not necessarily. Relying on passages elsewhere in the Talmud, the fetus is actually a part of the mother's body. And although one is not normally allowed to harm one's own body, obviously, if it's sake of saving yourself, you are allowed, for example, to amputate a gangrenous limb or something like that. So Rashi's position is not that it's murder, maybe it's something like manslaughter or something, or involuntary murder, but Rashi's position is much more lenient and allows for a larger scope of interpretation as to what you would rule, for example, if a woman's psychological health was at risk. Would you say that those are sufficient grounds for an abortion? Rashi might say yes. Rambam, on the other hand, would say no. And that debate of Rishonim persists to this day. In the 1970s, the Tzitz Eliezer, a very important Israeli rabbi, ruled that a woman who found that her child at the seventh month of pregnancy was carrying Tay-Sachs, very terrible disease, she said she can't take it and she didn't know what she'd do with herself. So the Tzitz Eliezer ruled that she could in fact terminate the pregnancy. Rabbi Moshe Feinstein in Israel said, very wrong decision. I respect the Tzitz Eliezer, but he is wrong in this point. We rule like Maimonides, the Rambam, and say that she may not terminate the pregnancy. So this is the kind of an illustration of how the debates of the Rishonim still very much alive today in contemporary thought. So he's one of these Rishonim. What do the Rishonim do? Some of them comment on Talmudic texts, and in fact, much of the Or Zaru'a is organized along the lines of the Talmud. It's structured according to the order and sequence of the Talmudic text. And he also wrote hundreds upon hundreds of responsa, and the responsa are especially valuable for us. Responsa are a form of halakhic literature in which a community or an individual sends a question, a she'elah, to an important rabbi, in this case, the Or Zaru'a. The Or Zaru'a does a research project on it and responds, hence responsa, or teshuvah in Hebrew, and that becomes Jewish law. That becomes the precedent that's later used. So we have amazing number of questions directed to the Or Zaru'a, which are relevant not only from a theoretical point of view of understanding what the Talmud means, but understanding what are the pressures affecting Jews in Vienna and the Danubian region in general. This is how halacha is formed. In particular, the Or Zaru'a is useful in that he begins to show us the origins of Ashkenazic custom. Let me give you some examples of this. But before that, let me just tell you a little bit about the unusual title, because he is, like so many rabbis, known by the title of his greatest work, right? Like the Rabbi Yisrael Meir HaKohen is known as the Chafetz Chaim. Chafetz Chaim is the title of his book. So the Or Zaru'a, Rabbi Isaac of Wien, is known as Or Zaru'a, the title of his book. It comes from Psalm 97:11, which is the phrase, Or Zaru'a means light is sown. Sown not as in like repair your clothes, but sown as in put seeds in the ground. The whole pasuk is here. Or Zaru'a la tzadik ula yishre lev simcha. Beautiful, very poetic passage. It translates literally as light is sown for the righteous and for the straight of heart rejoicing. It's a typical kind of Tanaitic or Tanakh-like phrase where the phrase is split in the middle with this esnachta here. The first part is light is sown for the righteous, and then the conditions are reversed to say, and for the straight of heart, joy. Meaning that if you are, the meaning of the verse is that if you are righteous, if you are pure of heart, then you may not be experiencing happiness right now, but it is sown, it is in the ground, and in the fullness of time, it will burst forth, and you will experience that great happiness. Perhaps a reference to life in the world to come. Now, he especially liked this phrase because when you take the final letters, you see it spells out Rabbi Akiva, Reish, Ayin, Kuf, Yud, Vais, and then ends in He. Sometimes Akiva is spelled with an Aleph. And he mentions in his introduction that he was drawn to this particular passage and the Sofei Tevo, the last letters of the words, because Akiva was his hero, referring to the Rabbi Akiva of the second century, one of the greatest rabbis of the Mishnah and the Talmud. In fact, at the very beginning of his book, there's this massive discussion of something that is associated with Rabbi Akiva's activity, and he begins this way because he wants to emulate Rabbi Akiva, who was someone who was darshan the osios, meaning someone who would derive meaning from the actual shapes of the letters. As you can see, this is the first page of the Or Zaru'a, and right at the very top, it says the alphabet in Hebrew. I mean, this is like, can you imagine opening up this massive 800,000 page book and the very first thing is A, B, C, D, as if you're going to learn the alphabet from, you know, like children's Siddurim, children's prayer books, open with pictures of the alphabet, lists of the alphabet with all the vowels. And it's so cute when you see little kids sitting there, you know, putting their fingers on the letters and sounding them out. So it starts like that, but then he gets into, he lists first the actual series of letters, then he lists how they are spelled out. Like, for example, the letter Aleph is spelled Aleph Lamed Fe, right? And he spells them out in full. And then he lists some of the secret combinations of the letters, the codes that you find occasionally in the Talmud. Like, for example, the At-Bash system. At is like the Aleph, the first level letter, is replaced by the Taf, the Lat letter, the last letter of the alphabet. The Beit, the second letter, is replaced by the penultimate Shin, right? And that way you can spell out a whole word or a whole sentence by reversing these letters, and several other less common ones. And then he goes into a long discussion which extends for about 30 pages about some of the secrets of the shapes of the letters themselves. This is out of character from the most of the work because it is deeply Kabbalistic, very much into gematria, numerology, and other things which are, you know, just an indication of the mystical background of the Or Zaru'a, which we shall see in terms of his influences. Is he a Mekubal? I would say he is. He would not make his reputation on it, but as we shall see, he was deeply influenced by a very important Mekubal, a very important Kabbalist. Okay, so travel and influences. Here's a passage, a page of the Talmud, a very old printing here. The Tosfot, by the way, are the commentators on the outside here. This is the actual text of the Talmud itself. On the inside, pride of place by the binding is always printed the commentary of Rashi, who is more of like a, he takes you hand and he walks you step by step through the meaning of the text. Tosfot, by contrast, is much more into discussing the contradictions and things like that. Rabbi Yitzchak of Vienna, is one of the members of the larger school of Tosfot. Perhaps the most well-known are the grandchildren of Rashi himself, but there are literally tens of scholars throughout Europe that contributed to this massive body of work. His teachers included the Arugat HaBosem, author of a very famous commentary and halakhic work, and his students included the Maharam of Rotenburg, whose biography is also quite fascinating. Perhaps we will refer to it in a later lecture. Perhaps my most favorite of his teachers, however, was Yehuda the Chassid, who is the most prominent individual in a short-lived phenomenon called the Chasside Ashkenaz. Fascinating explosion of spiritual activity, primarily in the Germanic lands towards the north, that has its own name now called Chasside Ashkenaz. The term Chassid, we speak today about Chassidim. Generally speaking, that term is used to refer to the followers of the Baal Shem Tov in the 18th century. Prior to the 18th century, the term Chassid was generally used to refer to anyone who went beyond the minimum standard. Anyone went beyond the letter of the law to do extra. David himself, King David, says, you know, Chassid ani, I am a Chassid, because he's always trying harder and things like that. But there are a couple of moments in Jewish history where the term Chassid is applied to a movement. It happened so in early medieval Rhineland, where they composed a group of rather unusually spiritually sensitive individuals who were deeply involved in various mystical practices and also ascetic practices. They had some things which today would seem rather weird. Like, for example, they were very big into atoning after death. So they would put their bodies in coffins after they passed away, and they would tell the Chevra Kadisha that they wanted the coffin to be dragged along the ground to the graveside as a way of expiating their sins in life. They should suffer those punishments after death. You know, those are kind of weird things. Immersion in snowbanks, things like that, you know, very, very aesthetic practices. It didn't really last. It only was there for about 150 years, and the Hasidic Ashkenaz kind of faded away. But they did leave us a rather remarkable book called Sefer Hasidim, which is a brilliant explication of some of their philosophical standpoints, and it's a strain in Jewish thought that has not necessarily survived, but is nevertheless fascinating in its detail. I will mention one thing that Yehuda Chassid wrote that is still extremely well preserved among Jews. You've probably heard of it. Maybe you've even considered it in your own private relationships. Yehuda HaChassid, the teacher of the Or Zaru'a, he left behind a fairly detailed will for his children that has a whole bunch of significant stipulations about how he wants them to behave and not behave. One of the things that he wrote to his children is that a man should never marry a woman with the same name as his mother, right? Right? And there's never, you know, that's the only source for it in the rest of Jewish tradition. It's not in the Talmud, not in halakhic literature. It comes just from, now we don't know what that means. He provides no source for it. No, it's him specifically. Yehuda Chassid said, don't ever marry a woman with your mother's name. Who knows what? So the halakhic literature later said, and just to be safe, also do it with your father too. But I have to share with you one thought from the great Kutzker Rebbe. When I say the Kutzker name, I have to straighten my tie because he was so brilliant. A 19th century Hasidic rabbi who wrote that if Yehuda HaChassid had known how seriously people would take his will regarding not marrying a woman with the same as your mother, if they knew how Jews would read his will with such intensity and dedication, he should have put the Ten Commandments in there too. That's the Kutzker. Self-flagellation was also their stuff too, yes. You see self-flagellation also come up in the Tzfat circle as well, but the Hasidic Ashkenaz were very big into this. You know, like, the Rambam was a very different kind of thinker as well. Yeah, he didn't see the value in it. And actually, it's ironic because the Hasidim themselves also try to put, the Baal Shem Tov was not a big fan of this. You know, he's saying like, we're not of the generation where we fast the same way the Hasidic Ashkenaz did. So the term is a little bit misleading. We use it in different ways, but this was a brief period of time where this was, as it were, the religious style. This is all, I think, fascinating stuff from a religious perspective. I, however, am a historian. So what's really cool, I think, is what can we do with the Or Zaru'a as a historical text? What can we learn about the nature of Jewish life in early Ashkenaz from the Or Zaru'a? And the truth is, we can learn a lot from it. So this is not the way the Or Zaru'a intended his book to be read. He was primarily composing a halachic treatise and a commentary in Talmud, but nevertheless, we have tremendous things that we can derive from it, and we have only begun to scratch the surface. As I mentioned, it was not published until the 1860s. Sefer Hasidim, because it's a very different kind of work, it has a lot of beautiful kind of parables in it, a lot of stories in it that are fascinating. It was printed much earlier, and a lot of work has been done on the Sefer Hasidim about the life of early Ashkenaz. The Or Zaru'a is just beginning to get that attention. 50 years from now, probably we'll have several monographs that tell us more about it. But let's just have a look at some of the things he did. So my first encounter was actually through this man's work, Alexander Harkavy, who was a great linguist. He wrote an amazing American Yiddish-English dictionary, which is actually worth reading cover to cover because there's so many amazing words in there. You know, he published it in 1907 after he had encountered American English. He adds words in there in Yiddish like sonofagon, you know, which is clearly American derivation. Fascinating book. But he was also really a great scholar of language, a language, early linguist, and he studied the or Zaru'a for the non-Hebrew terms that occur there. And fascinatingly, the or Zaru'a was fluent in many languages. He refers specifically to early Czech as Lashon Kana'an, the language of Canaan. And when he's looking for a particular word to describe, you know, some kind of object or animal or phenomenon, he'll use the Czech word. He'll say Belashon Kana'an, and then I'll give you the Czech word. The Czechs at this point were illiterate. They didn't have language. They didn't have anyone writing down their language. So ironically, anyone who wants to study early Slavic languages, they have to look to the or Zaru'a for the, you know, 2-3 dozen odd words that they can find. It is ironic that the earliest Czech words are written in Hebrew letters, because that's, we were literate and they weren't, and he was recording these things. It's an amazing phenomenon. We actually see it also with some of the Romance languages and Rashi, and even some Russian words occasionally occur in here. This is a fascinating phenomenon. So we can learn a lot from the or Zaru'a about early language. Not so interesting for Jewish history, though. What we also get from the or Zaru'a is a tremendous amount of discussion about commercial interactions with non-Jews and other social interactions. Because, of course, responsa literature addresses specific needs posed by questioners, it also relates stories about how Jews lived. So there's a lot of discussion, for example, about what is a Jew allowed to eat or drink if he's traveling and he stays in the home of a non-Jew? So right away you get the idea that Jews could travel alone. Jews could like knock on some peasant's door and say, hey, listen, I need a place to stay. I'll pay you, and can you give me some breakfast, like a Airbnb kind of place, right? And they're asking, what can I eat? What can I drink? What's considered acceptable? So the laws of kashrut are really what he's really concerned about, but we do get a lot of sense about how Jews interacted with non-Jews. Also a tremendous amount of discussion of business dealings with non-Jews, of the interference of church authorities. For example, the or Zaru'a lived at the time that the Fourth Lateran Council in 1215 decreed that Jews had to wear distinguishing clothing. And he has a lot to say about, you know, how Jews dealt with that particular regulation, whether they wore the hat, didn't wear the hat, wear the cloth, not wear the cloth, bribed individuals. A lot of discussions of what Jews could do with regards to non-Jews is discussed in the or Zaru'a. Some of them are fascinating. Like, for example, the question, normally, halakhically, a Jew is not allowed to carry armor on Shabbat, right? You're not allowed to wear a sword, carry a gun on Shabbat. It is unfortunately a sad reality that this halakhic discussion, of course, is, you know, as my father, Olive Shalom, used to say, plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. The more it changes, the more it stays the same. But this is actually a little bit different. So you're not allowed to wear armor on Shabbat because it's muktzah. It's something that you're not supposed to use on Shabbat, since you're not supposed to use it on Shabbat. You're not supposed to have a war on Shabbat. So therefore, you shouldn't be wearing a sword. There's a discussion, though, about what if it is like a ceremonial sword, like it's an adornment, like jewelry for a man, so to speak, a whole discussion of whether women can wear it as well. But the or Zaru'a deals with the question of, well, what if it's a Jew's turn to do guard duty in the city, and he has to walk around on Shabbat wearing a sword? Is he allowed to do so? So right away, that opens up a whole bunch of questions. Wait a second. They had Jews participating in the defense of the cities, and Jews were allowed to carry weapons, which they weren't in a lot of locales, for example, in Muslim lands. It just opens up a whole different picture of what it means for Jews to participate. If I remember correctly, in this case, he said, yes, he can, right? Which is probably feeds into the whole discussion of whether or not people can carry guns to shul nowadays, because it is for public safety. I'm not a rabbi. I'm not going to deliver a psak on this, but the or Zaru'a is one of the earliest discussions of this in the Ashkenazic period. Another thing that occurs frequently in the or Zaru'a, a remarkably common question, are Jews allowed to go hunting for pleasure? Are they allowed to join non-Jews on fox hunts and things like that. The Or Zaru'a says, no, you're right. But like, first of all, why not? Well, you're allowed to kill animals for food, and in doing so, you have to do it with particular prescriptions. There's a blessing to be said, and you know, certain kinds of methods of slaughter are acceptable, others not acceptable. You are allowed to kill animals that are noxious, like you know, snakes and spiders in your house, things like that. And there again, I'm not ruling halakhically, I'm just sort of discussing things in general. But then what about like something like fishing for fun? Are you allowed to fish, catch and release? Right? You know, can you do it? I'm not gonna give a psak. But what apparently the Or Zaru'a is referring to is that, yeah, you'd have like noblemen who would say, okay, on Monday, we're going out on a big fox hunt. Shlomi, you want to come on along? And Shlomi says, wait a sec, I've got to ask my rabbi. Writes a letter to the Or Zaru'a and asks him, am I allowed to hunt? Now, here's the question. As social historians, when you see a law repeated several times, what does that usually indicate? Yeah, that people are ignoring the law, that people are doing it anyways. Just like how many times we pass laws, for example, against marijuana consumption. Right, over and over and over again, and finally some countries simply say, okay, enough already. Could be that this country will do it as well, could be this state will as well, but the laws are repeated because no one's paying attention. And so it could be that when the Or Zaru'a has to say several times no hunting, it's because Jews are hunting. Good question. Okay, he also speaks significantly about the dangers that Jewish doctors face. Jews have historically been very active in the medical profession. I'm sure you know the joke about the first Jewish president of the United States. Oh, please let me tell you this joke. It'll make me feel really good. The joke goes like this. First Jewish president of the United States, he calls his mother up in Boca Raton. He says, Ma, I really want you to come to the White House. She says, oh, you know, why? When do you want me to come? He says, this Thursday, we finally solved the problem of peace in the Middle East. We're going to have a big signing in the Rose Garden. I really want you there, Ma. He says, Thursday, you know, that's my Mahjong night. He says, Ma, it's so important to me, please. I'm working for this, my first term, my second term. I really have to have you there. I'll send US-1, the Marine Force one will pick you up from the club, you know, you won't have to worry about it. So she says, okay, fine, I'm coming. Hang up the phone. Then she calls up her friend and she says, Sarala, guess what? My son, you know, the brother of my son, the doctor, he invited me to the White House. Right? My son, the brother of my son, the doctor. Right? Okay. All right. I enjoy telling these jokes. So he writes several places about the danger of Jews practicing medicine. Specifically, if the patient dies, a Jew is often accused of witchcraft. And so therefore he deals with a lot of specific questions about, you know, what if you can use this treatment, what if you use that treatment, consulting with non-Jewish doctors, and all kinds of things related to the danger of engaging in that profession. Finally, another area of significant value in the Or Zaru'a is regards Ashkenazic minhag, the origins of the specific practices of Ashkenazic Jews, of which the Or Zaru'a is a classic go-to text, because he's really describing what Jews did, sometimes in extra halakhic ways, that these are like customs that evolved in the region that don't necessarily have sources in specific texts earlier in the Bible, or we've lost the customs. He is a recorder of Unetana Tokef, the very, very powerful prayer that we utter on the high holidays, right? You know, who will die by fire, who will die by water, very moving prayer. He attributes it to Amnon of Mines, which is probably not a fair historical attribution, but nevertheless he records the presence of this very moving passage in the liturgy, and many, many other passages in our liturgy today. He also has discussions of what Jews eat. This is the earliest recorded reference to cholent in Jewish history, and in fact, the reference there is because he talks about how he was invited to someone's house, and the fire had gone out, and therefore they had to eat their cholent cold. And this horrible experience moved him so much that he recorded it for the next 1,000 years in the Or Zaru'a. But we know that the word cholent, I'm so glad you asked, it's clearly of French derivation. It comes from chaud, which means hot, and lent, from lentement, means long. Slow, hot, slow, hot. You know, you cook it overnight, right?
So in German, that's Schule Ende.
Schule Ende. Oh, that's pretty good, yeah, after Shula Enda. So do they have also like Kiddush Klubba? Or it's only like, okay, Shula Enda? Okay. This is so much fun. Okay, he also has discussions of like his impressions of synagogue decor. He writes about how he remembers the particular synagogues he used to go to that had, you know, drawings of birds and fishes and trees and stuff, and he disapproved. He says, we really should not be decorating our shuls like this. So it's indicative of kind of like the independence of individual congregations and his halakhic impact on them, and we can see how certain practices evolved as a result of his historic observations. Okay, so that's basically the story of the Or Zaru'a. We now have it printed in large new editions. This is the Or Zaru'a HaShalem, the complete Or Zaru'a, which sort of undoes the unfortunate lacuna in our historical record due to his son's well-meaning abbreviation of his text. And so the Or Zaru'a is once again on the cusp of being studied in depth in his own right, and we hope to integrate him well into the his rightful place in the Jewish tradition. Thank you very much for your attention. God willing, I'll see you next week. We'll talk about the Chasam Sofer.